Jesus Christ, who died and was raised to the glory of God the Father, grace and mercy be with you. We have come here today to remember before God our brother Peter, to give thanks for his life, to commend him to God our merciful Redeemer and Judge, and to commit his body to be cremated, and to comfort one another in our grief. Please sit down. Very warm welcome to everybody here today this afternoon for Peter's funeral. We've come to say goodbye to him, and we're going to commend his soul to God, and we're also going to celebrate and give thanks for his life. Those of you who've got an order of service will no doubt have seen all the lovely pictures on the front and inside this service, which shows what a really lovely man Peter was. We must remember none of us knows why these things happen the way they do, and we're all left asking the question, why? And there are no easy answers to that, except to say that Peter is now at peace and is spared any further suffering. We remember Peter as a kind, gentle man who loved his family more than anything else, but we must remember how much he enjoyed singing in the choir. It was the one thing in his life which really made him love life. And he managed to sing in the choir more or less up to the end, so that's really, really, really good. I know that you're all going to miss him terribly, but you have got your memories of him, and they should be cherished. We're going to begin our service this afternoon by remaining seated, and we're going to hear and hum. If you want to hum, that's fine. O Lord my God, when I am awesome to wonder,
Oh,
Almighty God, you judge us with infinite mercy and justice, and love everything you have made. We rejoice in your promises of pardon, joy, and peace to all who love you. In your mercy, turn the darkness of death into the dawn of new life, and the sorrow of parting into the joy of heaven. Through our Saviour Jesus Christ, who died, who rose again, and lives forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to ask Christine now to come up, and she's going to pay tribute to Peter.
Much to my surprise, Peter had given Emma and Nick a folder a few years ago containing information about his life. He told them that they would probably need it one day in the future, and that day has arrived. Peter was born on the 16th of May 1943 in Haymeads Hospital, Bishop Stortford, Hertfordshire. His father was abroad at the time on active service and didn't see Peter for the first 4 years of his life. His early years were spent in a small thatched cottage in Little Haddon. In 1947, Peter's dad returned home from the war and they moved into a tiny cottage on the Ford Manor estate in Dormansland, Lingfield, Surrey. His dad was gardener there until 1950. It was then that his dad applied for and obtained the position of head gardener on the Innsworth Estate Hall in Hampshire. They lived for the first few years in the bothy next to the wall garden, and it was there that Peter followed his dad around and his interest in gardening began. I shall always remember the wall garden. It was immaculate. Around the outside were tall, lean-to greenhouses containing rare plants, grapes, peaches, melons. Coming from a city background, I found the whole experience to be downright amazing. They then moved to a newly built tied cottage down on the hard road, and it was called Rose Cottage. Peter's dad always called it the hard road because it was the first time that his dad had ever lived on the edge of a tarmac road. Peter's last school was Cowplain Secondary School. He left in 1958 to follow in his father's footsteps and secured a job as a gardener with Portsmouth City Council, moving on to become an indentured apprentice in horticulture. He was working on the flower beds in Southsea when the Marines were practicing slow marching along the seafront in readiness for Winston Churchill's funeral. Peter was so pleased when he secured a place on the diploma course at Wisley, and over the years we have always visited the gardens if we were on the south coast. Upon leaving Wisley, he spent a year at the Institute of Park and Recreation in Lower Basildon, Berkshire. Having completed his training, he commenced employment with the County Borough of Worley, West Midlands, as a technical assistant. He left Worley during local government reorganisation and joined the landscape section of Birmingham City Council as a landscape officer and eventually became senior landscape officer, special projects. He retired in 2005. It was whilst he was working for Birmingham Council that he met his future wife, me. And that was the beginning of what was to be a wonderful lifetime of hard work, wonderful holidays and rambles around Worcestershire and beyond. The highlights of our life together were, of course, our lovely wedding day, the birth of our daughter Emma, meeting Nick, our son-in-law, the wedding day of Emma and Nick, and of course the arrival of our grandchildren. Peter was a very good, kind man who did his very best for his family. His first love, of course, was his family, followed by his love of church music and God's wonderful countryside. We ran the church rambling group in Bromsgrove, which enabled us to meet many lovely people and see some absolutely wonderful scenery. I shall always be able to see him striding it out across the fields and hills with his dad's walking stick. Our garden in Bromsgrove was beautiful, and Peter received many, many comments about it from the neighbours and passers-by. He was so pleased to be able to join the choir at Holy Trinity Church when we moved to Bembridge, and was even more pleased when Emma and Molly joined. I thank our friends at Holy Trinity for the friendship shown to us as a family, and in particular the help given to Peter by choir members over the last few months of him being a choir member. Rest in peace, Peter, until we meet again. Christine, Emma, Nick, Molly, Harvey and Jane.
In a time of silence now, let us make our own personal thanksgiving to God for all that Peter has meant to us. For Peter's life and all our memories, we give thanks. 23rd Psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures and leads me beside still waters. He shall refresh my soul and guide me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You spread a table before me in the presence of those who trouble me. You have anointed my head with oil, and my cup shall be full. Surely goodness and loving mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. I'm going to ask Claire to come up now, and we're going to hear the Gospel from St. John's Gospel.
A reading from the Gospel of John, chapter 14. Jesus said to his disciples, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I'm going." Thomas said to him, "Lord, we do not know where you're going. How can we know the way?" Jesus said to him, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you know me, you will know my Father also. From now on, you do know him and have seen him."
Lord, help us to accept and understand your gospel, so that we may have light in our darkness, faith in our doubts, and comfort for one another.
Amen.
I'm going to ask Sammy to come up now to read this poem, which you've all got a copy of in your order of service, "A Rose Once Grew."
A
very appropriate poem for a passionate coming up. A rose once grew. Near shady wall, a rose once grew, budded and blossomed in God's free light, watered and fed by morning dew, shedding its sweetness day and night. As it grew and blossomed fair and tall, slowly rising to loftier height, it came to a crevice in the wall through which there shone a beam of light. Onward it crept with added strength. With never a thought of fear or pride, it followed the light through the crevice's length and unfolded itself on the other side. The light, the dew, the broadening view were found the same as they were before, and it lost itself in beauties new, breathing its fragrance more and more. Shall claim of death cause us to grieve and make our courage faint and fall? Nay, let us faith and hope receive, the rose still grows beyond the wall, scattering fragrance far and wide, just as it did in days of yore, just as it did on the other side, just as it will forevermore.
Let us faith and hope receive, we read in that poem just now. And I want to talk to you this morning about the Christian faith, which can offer us hope and faith at a time like this. The first is hope for the future. The Christian faith stands for hope. The hope is for something beyond our life on earth. We often think of death as being the end of life, which in some ways is true. But as Christians, we believe that there is something beyond this life. And as in the case of Peter, there comes a time when we need to rest. While we are well in body and mind, when we live in God's presence and power, life in this world is a wonderful thing. We can enjoy the love of family and friends that we make on our life's journey. We can enjoy the good things the world offers us. The beauty of God's creation, our gardens, the adventure of travel, the inspiration of music, singing in the choir, the fulfillment of work on or a vacation, the pleasure of reading and eating, and other things that are precious to us. But when our work is completed and we begin to have to cope with the aches and weariness of advancing years, and some of those whom we've loved in our lives have gone from us, there comes a time when God's promises of eternal life become the source of peace and hope. I simply believe that this is the case for Peter. For most of us, even though we enjoy many of the good things that this life affords, there are times when sickness, pain, or sorrow becomes a burden. The Christian hope includes the conviction that in the life to come, those things are past forever. This again, we sincerely hope for Peter. The second thing our faith offers us at a time like this is comfort for the present. Of course, the hope we have, I just described, is in itself a source of comfort. But even better, our God is always ready to hear our sighs of grief and give us comfort. There is nothing a Christian need ever face alone. Wherever we are, whatever disappointments, troubles, pains or sorrows come our way, we have the assurance that God is with us to give us courage and strength. Later in this service, we will have a time of prayer. We pray because we believe that God is a listening God. We can bring to him in simple words our sorrow and our anxieties. God speaks directly to our hearts and minds more intimately than any fellow human being. Though, of course, we do have the precious words of the Bible to give us the comfort and hope we need. So as we leave this church today, which was Peter's parish church, and I've said already he sang for some years in the choir. Let us rejoice in that hope that when our life in this world is over, there is a new life for us in the world to come, and that those who are sad may find in God our Creator the comfort and strength that they can find in this time of sadness over losing Peter. We're now going to remain seated, and the choir are going to sing for us "The King of Love, My Shepherd Is." Show them the depths of your love, a glimpse of the kingdom of heaven. Spare them the torment of guilt and despair, and be with them as they weep beside the empty tomb of our risen Saviour, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Grant us, Lord, the wisdom and the grace to use aright the time that is left to us on earth. Lead us to repent of our sins, the evil we have done and the good we have not done. And strengthen us to follow the steps of your Son in the way that leads to the fullness of eternal life. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. this time of pandemic, a prayer for all the medical services. Gracious God, give skill, sympathy, and resilience to all those caring for the sick. And we give thanks for those who have developed the virus vaccines against COVID-19. Strengthen all the doctors and nurses with your spirit, that through their generous self-giving, many will be restored to health. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. In a moment of quiet, we bring before God all those who have died in this terrible COVID-19 pandemic. Remembering especially any family members and friends. Merciful Father, hear our prayers and comfort us. Renew our trust in your Son, whom you raised from the dead. Strengthen our faith that all who have died in the love of Christ will share in his resurrection, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Now the lovely evening prayer from Carmen and John Henry Newman. O Lord, support us all the day long of this troublous life until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes and the busy world is hushed and the fever of life is over and our work is done. Then, Lord, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Drawing all our prayers together, we pray as our Saviour has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Please stand. Let us commend Peter to the mercy of God, our Maker and our Redeemer. God alone is holy and just and good, and in that confidence, therefore, we commend you, Peter, to God's judgment and mercy, to God's forgiveness and love. Blessed be God the Father, who caused the light of Jesus Christ to shine upon you in your life. Go forth from this world in the love of God the Father, who created you. In the mercy of Jesus Christ who redeemed you, in the power of the Holy Spirit who strengthened you, in communion with all the faithful, may you dwell this day in peace. Amen. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy, slow to anger and of great goodness. As a father is tender towards his children, so is the Lord tender to those who fear him. For he knows that what we are made. He remembers that we are but dust. Our days are like the grass. We flourish like a flower of the field, and when the wind goes over it, it is gone, and the place will know it no more. But the merciful goodness of the Lord endures forever and ever towards those who fear him, and his righteousness upon their children's children. We have entrusted our brother Peter to God's mercy, and we now commit his body to be cremated. Earth to earth, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, ensuring certain hope of the resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our frail bodies that they may be conformed to his glorious body, who died, was buried, and rose again for us. To him be glory forever. Amen. Amen. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord, for they rest from their labours. And although we have been parted from Peter, none of us need ever be separated from the love of God. A Heavenly Father, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope in your Son, Jesus Christ. Help us to live as those who believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life. Strengthen this faith and hope in all of us as long as we live, so that we in turn may not be afraid to die. You are the Lord of heaven and earth. Your goodness never fails. Have mercy on your people who need your strength, and bless us now and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to ask you to sit again now, because we're going to have our final hymn, which is from my hymn, the prayer of the offer.
I'm falling off the path.
see him everywhere. He's all.